Very warm welcome to you all at National School of Drama's 21st International Bharatrang Mahotsav 2020. In today's Living Legend session, we have been bestowed with a fortune to meet and interact with the world-famous contemporary artist of India, Dr. Anjali Ila Menon ji. Born in Asansol, West Bengal in 1940, she is among India's iconic contemporary artists. She is well known for her finely wrought oil paintings, her window series, her work with painted objects, computer-enabled imagery and glass sculptures. After a spell in JJ School of Art and a degree from Delhi University, she studied fresco at the École de Beaux-Arts School of Fine Arts in Paris on a French government scholarship. Dr. Menon has held 55 solo exhibitions, including retrospectives at the National Gallery of Modern Art, Mumbai, and at the Lalit Kala Academy. Her work hangs in major museums and private collections globally. Three books and many films have been made on her life and work. She has done several murals in public spaces, including one in fiberglass at Esplanade Station, Kolkata. The Asian Art Museum, San Francisco, accessioned her seminal work titled Yatra after 6 months solo, the only Indian painter to be thus honored. She was awarded the prestigious Padma Shri by the Government of India and the Chevalier des Arts et Lettres, Knight of the Arts and Letters, by the French government, and the Lifetime Achievement Award of Delhi government in recognition for her contribution to Indian art. She has been conferred the degree of Doctor of Letters by Ravindra Bharati University. Please welcome with a huge round of applause Padma Shri Dr. Anjali Ila Menon ji. Ma'am, kindly come onto the stage. We have among us the director of National School of Drama, Professor Suresh Sharma ji. A humble request to you, sir, to kindly come onto the stage and welcome and felicitate ma'am on the occasion. We are eager for your address.
राष्ट्रीय नाट्य विद्यालय की तरफ से डॉक्टर अंजलि इला मेनन जी का हम हार्दिक स्वागत करते हैं. जैसा कि आप सभी लोग जानते हैं कि नाट्य कला में सारी ही कलाएं समाहित होती हैं और एस्थेटिक्स, पेंटिंग, स्कल्पचर, सारी की सारी कलाएं इकट्ठा होकर के नाट्य कला का वो एक संपूर्ण रूप प्रदान करती हैं. आज हमारे लिए बहुत ही प्राउड का विषय है कि हमारे बीच में डॉक्टर मेनन हैं, खास करके जो हमारे छात्र डिज़ाइन डायरेक्शन के साथ साथ जो अभिनय से भी जुड़े हुए हैं. तो ये जिस कला में आपने महारत हासिल की है, वो जो शेयर करेंगे आप लोगों के लिए बहुत ही ज़्यादा वो उपयोगी साबित होगा, ऐसा मैं मानता हूँ और ऐसा मुझे दृढ़ विश्वास भी है. तो एक बार पुनः राष्ट्रीय नाट्य विद्यालय की तरफ से आपका हार्दिक स्वागत और मैं हटता हूँ. काइंडली आप प्लीज.
थैंक यू सर फॉर योर काइंड वर्ड्स. लेट अस नाउ बिगिन द सेशन बाय आवर लेजेंड डॉक्टर मेनन. यू हैव द डेज.
इज दिस ऑन?
Is it? No. Can you hear? Yeah. Well, good afternoon all of you. It's wonderful to be back. I have been to this institution many times, but not for a few years, and I see so many improvements. And this wonderful Mahotsav which is going on with so many plays. As a person when I was your age, young in college, I was in Miranda House. We were very much part of the theatre group there. And I did many sets and acted also in some plays. So when I left college, it was a big choice between joining NSD and joining JJ School of Art. Of course, I chose JJ School of Art because I'd already been painting since the age of 15 or so with my great guru, Sushil Mukherjee, who taught me how to paint in oils ever since I was 11 years old. So it was pretty sure that I would want to become a painter. So we can start. I'm going to show you some paintings over the years, and with it we should also trace my journey through art. Now that is a portrait of my guru, Sushil Mukherjee, who taught me when I was still in school. And he went on later to teach in the United States, and I kind of lost touch with him. But he was a wonderful teacher. And in his studio, next to the art room, where I would always run to, there were lovely books. And that was my first introduction to world art, through those books that he would let us students go through. And he's a wonderful man. He was a man of many parts. He would sit, while we were painting, he would sit and play the flute. And he put on many plays. One of them was Mrityakatika, which I see is part of your festival today. So that play is evergreen. It seems to go on and on. And that was 60 years ago. Next. Very soon after I finished college, I had the wonderful opportunity of going to America on the first inaugural flight of Air India to New York. Surprisingly enough, I didn't go as an artist, I went as a model. And we were modeling, four of us women were modeling costumes of India, and I modeled Orissa costume and a Kashmiri costume. But that was a wonderful opportunity for me, and one of the places that we went to was, have any of you heard of Harlem, which was a very black and dangerous in those days area of New York? And I went one night to Harlem with some friends to listen to the jazz, because Harlem was very famous for its great jazz music. And this was, no, don't change yet, go back. This was my series of Harlem, of which I did about 8 paintings of the black singers of Harlem. I was very lucky also to meet Edgar Kaufman, who was the head of the MoMA, or Museum of Modern Art. I was only 19 years or 18 years old. So that was a big piece of luck. And he had a barn full of paints, which he let young painters go there and work. And I painted these Harlem series there. Next. Finally, when I ended up in the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris, I found myself very influenced by early Christian art, because it somehow resembled our own practice in India. I was always a maverick, always going in the wrong direction, I was told as a student. Because I should have been influenced by Picasso and Braque and the moderns, but instead I got rather influenced by very early art, in the 15th and 16th century art, and the Byzantine practice of those years. Next. So you see the Christ figure dominated many of the paintings of that era. Next. That again is a long, I call it the prophet, because I was so influenced by the icons, and I am to this day. It's that very full frontal, front-facing single figure that dominates the canvas, and that you'll see in much of my work. Next. This again is Mariam. Also influenced by the icons. Next. There you see the mother and child, the iconic mother and child, but my own interpretation of it. Next. As a woman, I mean, I don't really like to be isolated as a woman painter, but a woman's world is somewhat different from the world of a man, and it certainly devolves around having children, nurturing the young, and so this mother and child theme is very recurring in my work. My own children were, it was quite a miracle to have a child of one's own, and these pictures really dominate much of my work. Next. Now, at the moment, I have my studio inside Nizamuddin Basti, and it's a wonderful place because it is the village within the city, and village life goes on exactly as though there's no great high-rise city surrounding it. And one of the things that there are there in Nizamuddin much are these goat herds and their goats, and the goat appears in much of my work, and the bearded goat herds, the women goat herds as well. And the thing is that if I leave my studio doors open, the goats seem to wander in and eat up all the drawings. They love eating paper. So that happens quite a lot. Next. That's a portrait of my granddaughter. Next. Again, a mother with child. Next. Again, a portrait. Oh, that's an interesting story. That is, quite recently, went to the Far East, and in Cambodia, they have this place called Kanchanburi, where the monks pet the tigers, and the tigers, they have them, it's amazing, they have a tigers on a chain, or sometimes even without the chain, and the tigers seem to walk along with them. And you see this Cambodian monk, you see the little tigers in the background. And the man and tiger seem to be quite happy together. Unfortunately, later, after I painted the series of paintings, I heard a rumor that they actually drug the tigers, which is why they don't bite. And the monks feed them, and they give them a bath, and it's quite a tourist attraction, actually. Next. This was a whole series which I did called the Open Heart Series, because it really started when I was in Germany, and I found such a lack of people there. And it was an unfriendly time, I have to say. The Germans aren't very friendly to foreigners or strangers. And I felt sometimes I'd go and sit on a park bench and a person would sit next to me and not say a word. And I felt I wanted to open their chest and see their heart beating. Was there a heart beating there? Or were they as silent and still as statues? So there was this whole open heart series. Actually, it was a bit prophetic because I painted this series and you see that there's a cut down where this person has had an operation. And 2 years later, my husband had an open heart surgery and he still bears those scars. So somebody said, you're a witch. You have predicted something that never happened. Next. Next. Oh, the crow. The crow is there in many, many of my paintings, and people often ask, why the crow? For some people, they think it's an ill omen, but to me, he's just a friendly bird, very human. And it was the years that we lived in Bombay when I never had a studio. I used to work on the balcony, and this particular crow used to come and meet me every day, and I'd give him a bit of bread. And I knew it was the same crow because he would look at me with on both sides, and he was very knowing. And one day he just insinuated himself into the painting, and he's been there almost ever since. In fact, I finished a painting only yesterday of a woman sitting on a khatia, and there's a crow sitting beside her and looking at her. So the woman is probably me, now an old woman, not a young woman as before. But there is the crow, he's still there. Okay? There, he's there again. Yes. There are the goats, there are the crows, there's my the architecture of the Basti. I'm very near the Dargah. So I go there often, listen to the Qawwalis on Thursdays. It's very much part of my life. And all the people living in the same gully as my basti is, they're all my friends. I'm dadi to all the children. And it's very inspiring for me to be there. Next. That's an interior, as you see. And I have always been, generally, I've remained a figurative painter all my life. And in a few of the paintings where there is no figure, the figure has just been. Here the figure has just been inside, opened the window, left a cloth on the bench, left a lantern on the windowsill. It's not that it's without the figure. And in the far distance, there's the landscape beckoning. Some critic who saw this painting, which I painted soon after my marriage, said that for years the artist has been free roaming in Paris and Europe and hitchhiking everywhere. And now that she's married, she is stuck behind four walls and looking with longing out into the distant landscape. I don't know whether that's true. The critics seem to know more about one's work than one does oneself. Okay, next. There again, there's an interior. My crow is still there. This is the first of what I call my window series. Many things in art, I'm sure it happens in drama as well. A certain move, a certain something happens by accident, or maybe the protagonist of the play happens to trip over something and fall down, and then they make up some lines to cover it up. Well, in my case, I had to send a painting off for an exhibition, and suddenly the people arrived at the house to pick up the painting, and there was no frame. And I panicked. I said, now what am I going to do? I didn't have the car that day. I couldn't go and get it framed. So I went and looked in the garage, and there was this old window lying there. As it happened, the painting fitted exactly at the back of the window, so I nailed it on and sent the painting off. And it was a great success. Everyone remarked on it, the critics wrote about it, it was sold. And so it started this whole series of the window paintings, where I found old windows. I used to go to the Lakkad Bazaar in Bombay, and there you find old houses had been demolished and there were wonderful windows, and it was quite surrealistic because they had staircases going up into the air, not leading to anywhere. But I would buy some of these old windows and started to then get the canvas or board to fit into the window. Next, there's another one. And you see the paint on the windows is, I've left it as it is, the patina, which formed its own kind of antique finish. So there's another window. Oh, now this has come at the wrong part of the presentation, but this was fairly recently that I used to go to Murano in Italy to make sculptures in glass. Now this one is about that big, and it is a shivling made in crystal. Next. And there I did again in crystal, as you can see, the Ganeshji. Next. And there was a baby Krishna. There's a story behind this one. It got stolen actually at an exhibition in the Italian embassy in Delhi. But this exhibition, there were 53 pieces that I did. Over a period of time, I used to go to Murano in Italy and make these glass sculptures in the Chenedesi glassworks, very ancient glassworks. I was very lucky. I met somebody who allowed me to go and work there. At first, they were very skeptical. Who's this woman coming from India and what sculpture can she do? But we called it the Sacred Prism, the whole exhibition. And there were 53 works, mostly on sacred subjects. Next. That is a large painting, part of a big mural. Again, you see the crows sitting on the table. And the goat is there as well. And looking through the Again, this is a common sight in my basti, where you look through an arch and you see a woman in a rickshaw holding a chicken on her lap. So I continue to be very inspired by the happenings in my basti. Next. That is inspired. Did any of you see the lovely performance by Astad Debu recently? So this was inspired by a performance of Astad, where the dancer was leaping in the air and throwing these cloths up. So that is that's not Astad's face, but the stance and the leap was inspired by him, and the robes, the blue robes. Next. That is a painting that I did for my little nieces and nephews when they were very little, 1 year old and two and three, they were one and three in England, where they used to go to the park. And there on the park bench, right in the corner, there's a little dead bird, and there's a letter which has their 6 Roxeth Grove, their little address of where they lived in England, and the park with the swings and the balloons and the children's clothes hanging on the line. Next. This is called the Frenchman's House. There was a very eccentric Frenchman who was the cultural attaché in Delhi, and he lived in a house down the road, and it had very Art Deco house it was, and this was the chair. There's the crow, and there's a Kamadhenu statue on the ground. And you can't see it in this image, but up the table in the left-hand corner, there is a little lizard climbing up. The lizard also appeared in many of my works because I was brought up in cantonments. My father was in the army, and there was always these lizards walking on the walls of our houses. But they were friendly creatures, and one would be watching them going around in circles on the wall. So they are also there in many of my works. Next. Here is what I call, I did a series of chairs and windows, and here I deconstruct those. I think deconstruction and the ability to deconstruct is very important for an artist, because we paint what we see, but we have to metamorphose that in another way to make it our own. And there are many paintings where I have deconstructed the painting, the cloth on the chair, the crow, and the crows flying in the sky are still part, and there's a barbed wire fence. So these are all elements that have come together in the same painting. Next. Oh, I decided once, I was in Madras, and there was a gallery owner called Sharan Aparao, and I was sitting in her house, and I get very impatient if I have to pass the day without painting. And there was no canvas, there was no board, and I was bored to death, and I said, what can I paint? And there was an old chair lying there, so I painted the chair. And in the afternoon, one of the art critics, Geeta Doctor, came for tea, and she said, oh, well, that's wonderful. Why don't you do a series like that? So I went down in a rickshaw to a place near the canal where there were lots of old, broken down furniture, cupboards, chairs, tables, and I picked out a whole lot of things, and this is one chest of drawers with Kamal Hassan on it, and painted this whole series of painted objects. Next. And there's a cupboard, again with the chairs inside, and I used the front of the cupboard as a canvas. And this cupboard was then bought by somebody who keeps their jam and pickle in the cupboard. So it's a useful object, which is also an art object. So after that, there was actually many of the things that I've done as an artist were copied by other artists, and started a kind of a movement. And soon after this exhibition, which I had about 50 objects in Jahangir Art Gallery of various things, old shrines, cupboards, doors, Many people started having that same exhibition, and I think there are people who still buying old tin trunks and painting them, and it's become a kind of genre in Indian art. Next. And there you have a chair. I also did a couple of chairs, one with Musharraf and one with Bajpai. Just before that meeting, that famous meeting between them. And afterwards, when the meeting didn't go too well, I turned them around so that their hands weren't pointing to each other, but pointing in the opposite direction. Next. Now, this is, I think I was possibly the first Indian artist to use computer-aided imagery. Now, I find that 90% of the artists are using Photoshop or computers or digitally enabled work. But when I did it, it was very fresh. It was not very well received in India, but it was a grand success in New York. And this was, what I did was, on a computer, I morphed three different paintings of mine. Say one from the 60s, one from the 80s, and one from the 90s, to make a single image. So you hear, so you see fragments of earlier paintings in the same one, and then they were printed out, and I overpainted them. Because somebody who saw the printout said, there's no aura in a printout. You have to have the immediacy of actual paint, of actual pigment. So they were overpainted, and this was one that I did in New York 89. So as early as 1988, I started doing these computer morphed paintings. Next. So there's another one. As you can see, there are three different paintings morphed into one. Next. And then I did an experiment with kitsch, because what we call kitsch is really calendar art, and it is ubiquitous. It's seen all over India. In everybody's puja room, you find calendar art. And but we, as so-called fine artists, we look down upon that art. And I said to myself, why look down on it? Why not try to amalgamate it into our own work? And so I did a whole series of work that was inspired and again combined with calendar art. And this was one of them. I have, in this one, I think I used the calendar art cut up in pieces and made into a collage on that chair. So the painting is mine, again, a scene on the beach with balloons in the sky, a lotus floating in the sky as well, and two chairs. Of course, the crow, as you see, is still there. And two chairs are made of the cut-up pieces of a calendar. Next. And this was inspired, for instance, by the circus, where a chap is put into a box and then he's cut in half by the conjurer. And you see a Shiva-like figure also, very much from a calendar, surrounded by with a flower and a snake around him, and the tiger coming out of the box, a symbol of the fear of the little boy who's being cut up. Next. This is a painting called Yatra. All of you must have known about the Kavadiyas who go every year. They fill up the roads. And in those days, when I painted this, there was something simplistic and beautiful about the whole Kavadiya movement. They walked for miles and miles, pilgrims walking to Haridwar, to collect the holy water to take back to their own villages, and they had these two pots strung on a frame, and they walked. And I did a film as well. And this painting, it's huge. It's about 25 feet across. This was shown in the San Francisco Museum of Asian Art with a solo of 6 months where the drawings for the painting and the painting itself were accessioned by the museum. There was also a film which I made on the Kavadiyas walking. In those days they walked barefoot. Unfortunately, this has taken a bad turn now. They go in trucks and they have loudspeakers and they there are a lot of gundas who go and just make a noise. That holiness that was about this Kavadiya movement seems to have been vanishing slowly, which is great sorrow for me. Next. This is interesting because there you have again my goats, the goat people. But a critic said that now I had been influenced by the glass sculptures because the central figure seems to be made of glass, it's transparent. And I did a lot of paintings then of these transparent figures. I think I was influenced by working with the glass in Murano. Next. This painting was in the Bombay airport, the old Bombay airport. And as you walked towards the painting, right in the middle, there's a window with a mirror in it. So the people who were walking towards the painting would also be part of the painting. They would see their own image in the center of the painting. But now they, and as you see an angel flying in the sky, again, the transparent angel, and the frames of the katyas. That's the katya and the window are both recurring themes. Unfortunately, the painting was removed, and I don't know exactly where it is now, but the new Bombay airport came up, and I did 7 large panels for that, so I am still represented there. Next. This is what they call, the Buddha mural. This was in the old airport in Delhi. And when they, that was done 30, 35 years ago. And when they removed this big, it's about 25 feet by 10 feet. When they removed it, there was a big battle between the airport authority and Ministry of External Affairs. And finally, the Ministry of External Affairs got to keep the painting, and it is now in the VIP dining room of the new MEA building. Thank God we were able to rescue it, otherwise I suppose they would have just destroyed it with the rest of the building. Next. This is a very big mural which I've done. Again, this is nearly 40 feet long. It's in a hotel in Baroda, and it has all the features of the street in Baroda. You have on the right-hand side the man in the street giving a shave to a fellow. He set up a barber shop. The woman looking out of the window. Through the arch, again, you see the woman with going in a rickshaw. The little boy looking out of the window, peeping out from the door, and the Ghanta Ghar, which is part of Baroda, and the goats and the trees. So this is in fiberglass and it's backlit. So it's one of the big works that I've done. Next. And this is the work which I've done in the New Delhi airport. And it has all those same elements of the street, because what is written there on a plaque is the fact that the street in India is not just a road to go from A to B. A street is where people live. They celebrate their weddings, the lovers meet in the street because they have no room at home. The children play in the street, they play their cricket. The vendors are there selling ice cream, puchkas, golgappas, and you have the cinema there in the corner on the right hand side with Amitabh Bachchan in a movie, in the poster. So everything's there on the street. There's a taxi, there's an auto rickshaw, and all the various animals. So the street is a living place in our country. And as you people are doing the street theater right now, that's also your theater. It's your venue where you display your work. And so that is, I think, maybe the last. Is there another one? That's the last? Oh, there's another one here. This is, yeah, this is another big triptych. I'm trying to remember where it is. It's in some big collection. Yes, next. And this is the latest work I've done. You see me standing there. This is a huge work done in Ahmedabad for a corporate house. It's 14 feet high and 26 feet long. So it's taken me 6 months of doing nothing else but that painting. And I had to climb up on scaffoldings, which at the age of 80 is not so easy. Ladders and scaffolding to get to the top. And but I enjoyed doing it, and it was a great relief when it was finished. I wish I had a better photograph, but you can't step back enough. The room's not large enough to step back to get a good picture. So thank you, that's it. I'm very happy to take any questions, comments. Yes? I think we can put the lights on now. So I can see you. You can see me, but I can't see you.
Hello, ma'am. Good afternoon. It was a huge treat to watch your works. I just had one small inquisition. You just said that you were influenced by the previous styles, no doubt, but in most of your paintings the eyes are also very symbolic. So every time I saw a picture, I thought maybe if you had the eyes on, you know, it would have been much more attractive, or rather I would have wanted to know how you would have drawn eyes.
Well, so I that was the only painting question which is painting is very self-indulgent, and I think maybe I don't want to reveal myself entirely.
So you would like to be mystic and
keep
mysterious.
Keep something enigmatic. See, keep something a little hidden or mysterious.
Yeah, thank you so much. Huh. But then, as a woman, you said a woman's world is totally different. And I realized that there are many things which you have drawn from silence, from just observation, and from the time which you have got of your own. But it's quite interesting that everything revolves around you, what you have seen, and the space around you live in, the streets, the so it was very interesting. But then the work of the calendar art was, we have another artist, Pushpamala, also, I'm
yes.
sure. Yeah, so I was reminded.
Well, she after I did the exhibition on the calendar art,
yeah.
Soon after there was a big exhibition with other artists, which was called Kich Kich Hota Hai.
Yes.
And after that, it really became a movement. There are many artists now
yes.
working with calendar images.
Yes.
But I thought that I should come out of the closet as far as that is concerned.
That's
and
so wonderful.
Start engaging with that. In fact, I think what inspired me a lot was the embellishment in it. Amazing detail and all that gold work. And that reminded me very much of the Byzantine work.
Yes.
Of
but
my
it's
early
very interesting that you spent your childhood in Tamil Nadu, where you. That was the time when, during your teenage, when a child grasps most of his inputs and learning.
Yes.
So it's but it's quite also surprising that you are much more influenced by the Western Byzantine times.
I was, to begin with, until I got married. And then I was exposed to a lot of wonderful imagery from Kerala. Unfortunately, in this visual, they weren't those paintings. But my husband comes from a small principality called Kolangod.
Okay.
And there in the palace, I found many daguerreotype photographs. those ones that were done on glass
okay.
and tin. And they were in sepia, and I was very influenced by that. So that was, a lot of people drew the comparison between Shergill's journey and mine. We were both at the Beaux-Arts in Paris.
Okay.
We both started out by being influenced by the West. And finally, it was the journey to the South that ended up in the final very Indian works inspired by Indian subjects.
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am. It's been a treat.
Not at all. Any more? Yes, at the back. Just give him the mic.
Hello, ma'am. You just said the connection between you and Amrita Shergill's painting and the career you had. You just talked about Amrita Shergill and your work and the way you started out in the West and then did paintings. Even as you see Kalpana Lajmi's painting, when I saw your paintings, there were women figures which were, if you see Kalpana Lajmi's painting, are same way, the eyes are blurred a bit. So do you draw any connection there?
Not really. I mean, I think what is actually the actual facts, you people are lucky because you all work in a group and you interact with each other, but a painter's oeuvre and life and work is very lonely. I'm alone in my studio. I interact with very few people. What I'm seeing out of the window are subject matter. They are not actually related with me in any way. So whatever occurs does occur as a personal interpretation of the visual matrix of our times. Sometimes it's very earnest, sometimes it's very personal. I painted a lot of my aunts, my grandchildren, my women friends. That's why a lot of women dominate the work, because they were the natural models for my work.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? No questions?
हेलो मैम
हेलो
जब आप अपनी पेंटिंग बनाती हैं खुद की पेंटिंग जब करती हैं तो आप एक किसी फोटो का अपने रेफरेंस लेती हैं या फिर इमेजिन करके उसको बनाती हैं
कभी कभी वो मैंने वो जो कोलंगोट के फोटोज़ का रेफरेंस लिया था वो एक पूरा सीरीज था उनमें कम से कम 10-12 पेंटिंग्स किया था मैंने एक बड़ा पेंटिंग वो सीरीज़ का या दो नेशनल गैलरी ऑफ मॉडर्न आर्ट में है कभी कभी एक छोटी चीज़ का रेफरेंस ले लेते हैं मगर ज़्यादा तौर से जो मैं खुद देखती हूँ उसी से पेंटिंग बनाती हूँ कोई सब्जेक्ट मैटर रहता है
थैंक यू
इट्स वेरी इजी टू वर्क फ्रॉम फोटोग्राफ्स बट आई ट्राई टू अवॉइड Because when photography replaced painting, then for instance, let's talk about portrait painting. Portrait painting is very important when there was no photography. Everybody wanted to be remembered by the next generation, so apna portrait nikalwate the. Magar jab se photography shuru ho gaya hai, you don't need to be painted in oils or watercolors. The photograph is there for the next generation. Any more? Should we end there then? Oh. Okay. Oh, one more there. Just give her the mic.
Namaste ma'am. Aap ek painting dikhaya abhi, three women's, three parts. डिवाइड हुआ था इस पेंटिंग्स में मुझे देख के थोड़ा कन्फ्यूजन हो रहा था मीन्स अलग अलग पार्ट अलग अलग जगह पर था आप पेंटिंग करने के समय आपको कैसा इमेजिन होता है मीन्स हमको बहुत कन्फ्यूजन लगा देख के कहाँ है ऐसा
बात है कि इंस्पिरेशन क्या चीज़ होती है जो हम एक ब्लैंक कैनवस के सामने बैठते हैं सुबह, तो वो हमारा समय है प्रार्थना के लिए भी. दैट इज़ माई रिलीजन, माई वर्क. आई ट्राई टू बी अ कर्मयोगी. एंड आफ्टर दैट आई लेट द पेंटिंग मेक इट सेल्फ. वो अपने आप बनते जाता है. आई ट्राई नॉट टू इम्पोज सम आइडियाज़. वो बाहर से आइडियाज़ उसको उनके ऊपर इम्पोज नहीं करते हैं. शायद वो पेंटिंग एक सीरीज़ का पेंटिंग एक होगा. सपोजिंग इट्स अ मदर एंड चाइल्ड सीरीज, तो मे बी आई डू द मदर फिगर. बट उसके कपड़े और वो बच्चे का शक्ल, वो तो अपने आप बदलते जाता है. यू हैव टू लीव योर सेल्फ ओपन एंड इनोसेंट. तो यू विल बी अम्यूज्ड ऑल ऑफ यू टू नो दैट व्हेन इंटरनेट स्टार्टेड, मैंने उसको रिजेक्ट कर लिया. आई डोंट डू इंटरनेट. आई बेली नो हाउ टू डू द फ़ोन बिकॉज आई डोंट वॉन्ट टू बी बॉम्बार्डेड विद डेटा. ज़्यादा डेटा हो जाता है तो यू डोंट हैव अ ब्लैंक कैनवस इन फ्रंट ऑफ योर आइज. तो हमको वो ब्लैंक कैनवस चाहिए. एंड आई थिंक इन द थिएटर ऑल्सो, यू इफ यू आर गोइंग टू बी क्रिएटिव, राइट न्यू प्लेज, यू नीड अ ब्लैंक कैनवस. यू डोंट हैव टू डिपेंड ऑन द प्ले दैट वॉज रिटन यस्टरडे बाई समबडी एल्स. यू वॉन्ट, वॉट इज द डेफिनेशन ऑफ ओरिजिनैलिटी, द डेफिनेशन ऑफ क्रिएटिविटी, उसके लिए एक ब्लैंक कैनवस बहुत ज़रूरी है. आप लोग मानते हैं कि हो सकता है आपके प्रोफेशन में?
यस मैम. यस.
हाँ. ओके.
थैंक यू.
हाँ जी.
हेलो मैम.
हेलो.
As you said before, in your painting there is a similar, in every paint there is a similarity of a crow. You said that it will come to the place where you were doing a painting. It has to sit in the canvas. So I want to ask you something. Is there any motivation that you got from that crow, or else is there any story?
No, he's my friend. He's my dost. बस वो आता है, अपने आप आता है, अपने आप कैनवस में घुसता है और वो मेरा दोस्त है.
Then,
उसमें कोई सिंबलिज्म नहीं है. सिंबलिज्म नहीं है उसमें.
But what made you to relate the crow in all the paintings?
No, not in all the paintings. कई कई जब मैं बॉम्बे में जाती हूँ तो ज़्यादा क्रोज आ जाते हैं क्योंकि वहाँ बहुत क्रोज हैं. और यहाँ एक दिन क्या हुआ, हमारा एक छोटा फार्म हाउस है, फार्म हाउस में गए, हमने देखा हजारों क्रोज आ रहे हैं. तो हम अचानक हो कि क्यों आ रहे हैं ये क्रो, इतने कौवे. तो देखा है कि एक कौवा मर गया है और वो सब फ्यूनरल में आए हैं. सो दे आर सो ह्यूमन. हाँ, अफसोस करने के लिए 1000 क्रो पहुंच गए थे.
थैंक यू
मैम. गुड आफ्टरनून मैम. आई एम अ कॉन्सेप्चुअल आर्टिस्ट. माय क्वेश्चन इज, जब आपने बताया कि फोटोग्राफी इज़ अ फॉर्म ऑफ आर्ट विच इज़ कम्पीटिंग विद द पेंटिंग विच इज़ ए पैरेलली एमर्ज्ड आफ्टर पेंटिंग हैज कम अक्रॉस, थिंग इज हाउ कैन वी मेक अ पेंटिंग डिफरेंट व्हेन द फोटोग्राफी इज ऑलरेडी देयर,
व्हेन द
फोटो इज ऑलरेडी देयर, इट हैज़ बीन डिजिटली कैप्चर्ड. हाउ कैन वी मेक द पेंटिंग मोर डिफरेंट और मोर एनहांस्ड एंड different than the photography that is already existing?
Well, we talked about deconstruction, no? So the artist is free to eliminate certain things. Many artists don't do a nose, don't do eyes, or you can dress your protagonist. You might notice that in my paintings they're not dressed in a sari or a salwar kameez. They cannot be placed geographically. Koi imaginative कपड़े पहना देती हूँ. They should be universal. That is my, the figure should be universal. It should not belong to Delhi or belong to New York. It must be just human.
Okay, I have one more question. What is that one aspect of painting?
What is the
one aspect of painting which is unique compared to all the other mediums? It could be a video, it could be a photography. Which is one aspect of the painting medium? art?
Well, I think it is the autonomy of the painter. I think we have a wonderful canvas before us. You can do anything on it. You can, I mean, there are so many genres of painting today. You can cover yourself in paint and roll on a canvas, wo bhi painting hai. You can leave a blank canvas, wo bhi painting hai. You can make an installation, wo bhi art hai. So we have enormous autonomy. Jo bhi marzi hai, wo kar sakte hain. For you people, it's harder. You have an audience there, sitting and watching your play.
Compared to theatre
so
also.
You can't, but even then, in theatre also, you can have great imagination. Quite often I see with the costumes, they don't relate to any particular time or period. I think of Brooks' Mahabharat, where the people were not dressed in so-called Indian costumes. And it was Raja Ravi Varma who first started dressing the gods and goddesses in the clothes of his times. After all, when you look back on the Ramayana, there was no tailor. Tailoring came to India in many, many centuries later. But you will see with Raja Ravi Varma's paintings, they are still dressed with blouses, stitched blouses. So that is the artist's imagination. It's very clear that they only had cloth. Maybe in the Ramayana's time they did not even have cloth. We don't know historically whether there was fabric or not. So it is up to the artist to dress the figure in what his imagination dictates.
Any comments on conceptual art? Conceptual art, ma'am.
On?
Conceptual art.
Conceptual art, yeah. Well, there are many, many things happening in the art world today, and conceptual art is one of them. In conceptual art, you have the message clearly written in alphabets. And though I feel with symbolic art, I've always told young artists who come to me who do symbolic paintings, the symbolism must dictate itself. The artist is not standing there to explain his paintings. So if you have a fire in one corner and a dying dog in the other corner, the artist is not there to tell you what it is about. So it must explain itself. It must explain itself.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Yeah.
Many of the artists, they say that there is no movement for a painting. It's a stagnant.
No?
Movement.
Yeah.
It's a painting is a stagnant. Yeah. So is it true that a painting doesn't have any movement?
Any movement?
Movement.
Yeah. Many people are doing what they call video art. There's a person, Ranbir Kaleka. His painting, you can see the painting there and then it moves. It moves. So modern technology has taken us way beyond what I am doing. I still paint with paint and canvas and a brush. But there are very few painters doing that these days. Most children are using Photoshop, they're using video art, they're using technology to make moving images. So the gap between photography, movie making and painting is narrowing down. There's one is overlapping the other in many instances. Yeah.
Thank you.
Ma'am, I have another question which I suddenly realized. Your paintings have a very intricate and unique palette combination, which takes, for me as a personally, I would like to stand and watch a painting for quite some time. But when I went through in my mind, it kind of takes me into an inner journey within myself. So, like you would not have any large bright colors splashing yeah. across.
Yeah.
So, your choice of the color palette, is it unconscious or was it also
no,
an influence
I,
of the...
I feel that the relationship between the painter and the viewer is very important, and in many times I've had the viewer come to me and say, that chair that you painted is my grandmother's chair.
Yeah.
That a chair with some threads have come out and it's looking in a bad condition. And I've had two people coming and fighting over that chair and saying, isn't that the chair that used to be in Nani's house? So that kind of contact between the viewer and the painting continues to be very important to me. And I feel that a viewer should not, I mean, that is not to say that there should not be grotesque paintings.
No, but no,
I feel
that your choice, which is there's some magic in that.
Should not be deterred from interacting with your painting.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what happened. It, in spite of not having the picture in front of me, it went into my mind, and so I was like, it keeps intriguing you. It comes back to your consciousness.
Yeah, I think the viewer
which creates a magic within its own.
Well, magic is the word we all strive for.
Yeah.
Every artist, and I think that's every playwright, every actor, every painter, every singer, waits for that magic.
Happened.
If you achieve the magic, I think that is the greatest gift that a creative person can have. You don't achieve it in every painting. Maybe five paintings out of I think I must have done about 5,000 paintings.
So how many of them do you think you have had magic on?
Sometimes.
You have some of your favorite paintings also?
You achieve the magic sometimes, very rarely. And I think that's in theatre too, that magic moment on the stage where you know that the audience is there in your hand, isn't it?
So only when the painting is over and somebody comments about it, then you feel the magic, or do you feel the magic happening?
You have to see it yourself.
You have to see it before.
Sometimes the painting is praised to the skies and you don't think much of it, huh? But I think the critics and viewers and the voyeurs are a class apart.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Not at all. Okay, the last one. Last question.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Just give it to her first.
Mera sawal hai aapke kaam se related. Jab aapki paintings hum dekhte hain, to there is this very strong sense of going local, going very personal, and also I see a lot of Indian colors and a lot of Indian motifs around. So I really want to seek some insight for us young artists. What would you like to say that going personal or going local is going global, basically? So I would like to have your views on it.
I think every painting has to be personal. At least that is my philosophy. I paint from my own imagination. The visual matrix which I see around me, I might pick certain elements from it, not everything. If I see a chair, I might see only the arms or the legs. If I see a child, it might be without clothes. I'm not necessarily painting the child that I see. I'm painting the child of my imagination. I might take a hint from what I see, and what I see might inspire me to do something else. And certainly the combinations of things in the painting is not as you see it. It may be a window from one house, a chair from another house, a person from a third place, and some element of self-portraiture as well. Yeah. You wanted the last one.
Hello, ma'am. Myself, Ashwini. आपने अभी बोला था कि मैंने थिएटर में भी डिजाइनिंग किया है तो मैम तब की जर्नी आपकी कैसी थी और अभी आपको नहीं लगता है क्या कि ऐसे करना चाहिए मतलब थिएटर में
मौका मिलेगा तो ज़रूर करेंगे मौका मिलेगा तो ज़रूर करेंगे बिकॉज इट्स थ्री डायमेंशनल हमारा जो पेंटिंग है ना इट्स ओनली टू डायमेंशनल और थिएटर अभी हमने सेट किया था फॉर जाकू हिल का सेट रिसेंटली आई डिड बट व्हेन आई वाज इन कॉलेज मिरांडा हाउस आई डिड फॉर two plays of Tennessee Williams, and I think I designed sets for three or four plays. And because of my sets and the criticism in the papers about my sets, I was invited to be a delegate for the theater festival in Avignon. And I met Jean-Louis Barrault. Yeah. I would love to do some sets, yeah. Ask me. Okay. I think that's it.
Ma'am, it was an amazing experience to witness your work and listen to your stories of inspiration. Your words and insights will prove to be an inspiration to a lot of us present here today. We're extremely honored and grateful to you for being with us today. Ma'am, thank you for your magic.
It was a lovely audience. Thank you.
We would also like to thank our wonderful audience for the day. And invite you all here again for the two-day national seminar on theatre as social responsibility or public need on 15 February 2020 at 10 a.m. Have a happy BRM. Thank you.